Good morning. Can you hear me in other places? Yeah. Okay. Good. Do you see slides on your screens? Okay. Thank you. All right. So coming back to the... Just a second. I will manage mouse. So we are continuing study of the Heisenberg group, and actually at this point where we already introduced the group law and described action of the group by left and right shift on itself, provide a left and right invariant vector fields, describe the Lie algebra, which is known as Weyl algebra, we may already proceed to certain applications of the Heisenberg group, and I may pick up certain topic in analysis or quantum theory and point out how Heisenberg group is related to them. But my aim is a bit more ambitious. I would like to demonstrate what Heisenberg group is not only connected to certain topics. I would like to show how these topics exactly appears from the Heisenberg group. So if you studied Heisenberg group in sufficient details, you sooner or later came to exactly a description of very important tools and objects in mathematical analysis and in quantum theory. And for this purpose, we will need a little bit more time describing the property of Heisenberg group itself. So we will study maybe today and the next lecture. Still, we will be working just within the Heisenberg group. So no external fields will be connected at the moment. But as soon as we manage to have sufficient background, we will develop quite a lot of applications just as a consequence of structural situation with the Heisenberg group itself. So we stopped last lecture on describing automorphism of the Heisenberg group. So there are here two tasks. One is simple. Is to verify what indeed four type of transformations which are presented now on the screen provide an automorphism of the Heisenberg group. And it's not very difficult in this way. So if you already have a transformation, you apply them to elements of the Heisenberg group and see that group law is invariant under these transformations. So that is an easy task. A more complicated task is a demonstration what this is all automorphism. No other transformation of the Heisenberg group are possible which preserve the group law. The full proof may be found, for example, in the Folland book analysis on the phase space. And here is just a simple outline how that proof will go, outline which again highlight certain important properties of the Heisenberg group, so it's worth to be described. First of all, again, that is a general result about Lie algebras and Lie groups. What we may simplify problem if we will linearize it, so if we will speak not only about the automorphism, or rather speaking about automorphism of the Heisenberg group, we will speak about automorphism of the corresponding Lie algebra, Weyl algebra. So we will linearize it. And that is, of course, not true for all Lie groups, but this is true for so-called exponential Lie groups, the Lie group where we may through the exponential map, identify Lie group and Lie algebra. So in this case, Heisenberg group is a particular example of this exponential group. And from here, it follows what any automorphism of the group will lead to an automorphism of the Lie algebra and vice versa. When if we speak about automorphisms of the group, this group shall preserve Lie group law. It shall also, on the level of Lie algebras, preserve the commutator. So, because commutator encode essential information about the group law. So, knowing the commutator allow us to restore the group multiplication. So, for this reason, if automorphism of the Lie algebra preserve the commutator, it will also preserve the decomposition of the Lie algebra. We decompose it into direct sum of subspaces V0 and V1. So this is this decomposition which we have. So that shall be preserved as well. And as such, space V1 shall be an invariant subspace under the corresponding shall be an invariant subspace under the automorphism. And then it's easy to show again that if we have such a transformation which preserves space V1 on which it acts linearly, then there is no much choice what happened on the space V1. That can be either the scaling or multiplication by minus one, then, or certain symplectic transformation. Then that corresponds based on this information about transformation of subspace V1, we can obtain the full description of the automorphism of the Heisenberg group. So again, this is outline of the proof. Details are important and interesting, but it presented here without details just to demonstrate the connection of the material, the structural properties of the Heisenberg group, which we described so far, to that classification. Speaking about the Heisenberg group and the group of its automorphism, it's natural to define so-called semi-direct product. The simple example of semi-direct product, simplest probably a possible example, is the affine group, affine transformation of the real line. So start from the real line and consider it as one-dimensional Lie group, with the addition. So you have shifts of the real line. And this is a very simple commutative Lie group. Then consider scalings of the real line. So if you multiply all real numbers by a certain factor, then due to distributive law, that will be an automorphism of the group of reals under addition. So, and whenever you have such automorphisms which preserve the group law, you may build a semi-direct product. You combine together an action of shift and scaling in the case of affine group, and that will be all possible affine transformations of the real line. So there is a very simple formula how to check what will be result of consecutive application of two such affine transformation. So if you add one transformation is scaling and shift, and when you apply another transformation with another value of shift and another value of scaling, then scaling from the second transformation should affect shifts on the first one. This is group law. This is principle which is encoded in the semi-direct product in the formula 17. So on the Heisenberg group, we again may think about Heisenberg group acting by shift on itself as just a real line act on itself by shifts, by real numbers. And then instead of the scalings, which are automorphism for shifts on the real line, we introduce the full group of automorphism of the Heisenberg group. So we combine together the shifts and that automorphism, and group law will be as follows. I'm sorry, we have fire alarm here. According to the procedure, we have to leave the room. I don't know if this lecture will be resumed or not. Sorry. Hello, can you hear me again? So that alarm is switched off now, so we continue. I apologize for the interruption in the lecture. So we defined Schrödinger group as a semi-direct product. So the group law is presented on the screen. So again, this is just a particular realization, or maybe even not very special realization, quite general formula, which work for any semi-direct product, which again can be defined for any group with its automorphism, so its extension through the automorphism. As you can see again from the name, Schrödinger as a Heisenberg, which is another prominent physicist who contribute to development or even birth of quantum mechanics. So we may naturally expect that that group will have a certain implication for our construction, and we will see it later. So the one thing what here we need to consider really not the symplectic group as automorphism of the Heisenberg group, but rather its double cover, and that contribute to half-integer spin numbers, in which we know in the appear in the quantum mechanics, and what energy of ground level for electron in the atom is the one half of Planck constant times frequency. It's not the entire Planck constant. So that is again just come from the that fact of double cover. And that, again, related to the fact what we need a proper orientation on the symplectic group in order to work as automorphism for the Heisenberg group. Now, again, quite standard mathematical approach. If we are studying a certain class of objects, then what we typically do, we decompose our object into smaller object of the same type. So the typical situation in linear algebra, you have a big vector space, you are studying either that space or maybe operator on that space, and you decompose your space into subspaces, into direct sum of certain subspaces with nice properties. Similarly, when we are studying group, to understand their structure, we need to consider certain subgroups, smaller one. And then the property of entire group will come out from that smaller, simpler object. For the our study, another relation of that approach is that every abstract group, so far we introduced the Heisenberg group as a certain abstract group, a group which given by its group law on a certain set. But practically, groups oftenly appears in the studies, in our studies, as transformation groups. We have certain sets which are transformed by our group. And for these transformations, again, if we will use the standard approach, we need to consider orbits. This is images of one particular points. When you apply all possible transformation to these points, you get an orbit, and the group act transitively on the orbit. When there is a classical theorem, very maybe not even classical, it's a rather elementary theorem, which tell us what such an orbits, spaces where our group act transitively, they called homogeneous spaces for this reason, that homogeneous spaces are in one-to-one correspondence with subgroups of our group. In fact, if we will consider the factor space equivalence relation, so we introduce equivalence relation on the group with respect to certain subgroup, we call two elements on the group are equivalent if there is an element H from the subgroup such what identity highlight identity hold, then homogeneous spaces can be identified with such equivalent spaces. How to see this or how to make that construction more explicit? We introduce the natural projection from the group to that equivalence classes. So every element of the group is assigned its equivalence class under such equivalence relation. So this is projection P. Of course, this is many to one map. So usually we have many elements in one equivalence class. So P as a projection does not have an inverse. But what we may try to find out here, we are looking for the right inverse of P, not full inverse, but only inverse from the right. That means from every equivalence class, we pick up a certain representative element of the group which belongs to this equivalence class. It will be representing this class for us. And then, naturally, if you apply first S and then P, so if you pick up a representative from equivalence class, then project back to equivalence class, you get the equivalence class which you started from. For the Lie group, it's a special theorem that map S, usually if it's right inverse to the projection, it's called section. So such a section, this is why it's letter S here, may be taken continuous. So this is quite important and not very maybe so obvious result, but we will use it without proof. What we may pick up that section continuous. In our particular examples, it will be easy to verify what our map S is smooth, so it will be easy to see. For us. When we may define the left action of the group G on that equivalence classes. Of course, there is a left action lambda. So this is notation lambda will be used many times. So this may be a definition of this lambda. This is a left shift on the group. We are map element by multiplying from the left. For the purpose of function, keeping that as a group homomorphism, we need to take inverse. If we multiply from the left, our group is non-commutative, and keep it as a group homomorphism with shift, we need to take inverse element. If we multiply from the right, then elements taken as they are, but if we multiply from the left, inverse shall be taken, just to change order of multiplication when we do our calculation. When there is the projection of this left action onto that equivalence classes which parameterize points on of particular homogeneous space. So that formula expression is highlighted and it's also illustrated by the given diagram. So we need to start from the lower left corner where we take element from the equivalence classes or homogeneous space. We put bisection element of, well, it, pick up a representative of this homogeneous, with equivalent classes. Representative, this is element of the group. When we multiply that element by the group from the left, and when we what we will obtain will be element of certain equivalence class. Maybe it will not be the representative element for this class, but it's not important. When we are doing projection, we are picking up which homogeneous class it belong to, equivalence class it belong to. So that make the that dot operation. So group operation will be denoted by star. Action of the same group on corresponding homogeneous space will be denoted by element G. Yes. Well, if you just take two such shifts, if you take shift by G1 and G2 in this formula, and you want what resulting will be shift with G1 times G2, you need to multiply by the left, by the inverse, so that has happened. If you multiply from the right, that there is no change of order because it's belong stay from on the other side when you do multiplication. So it's just necessary to write it down. So probably. Well, yes, yes, it look opposite, yes. But what we are aim to, we introduce the function, and when function reverse things again. You see, if you want, you are, if you considering it geometric action on points, yes, you are right. It shall be opposite way, but we will considering representation on function, and that will be sorted out then, right? Yeah, but thank you for carefully listening and verifying what I am talking. Yes, you are spot exactly the principal point. We are moving to functions soon. All right, so in order that construction tell us what to classify all homogeneous spaces, we really need the classification of subgroups. And for our purposes, we don't want to have situation with certain complications. Our subgroups will be continuous subgroups because discrete subgroups lead to certain other cases. So if we will consider a discrete subgroup of the Heisenberg group, it will be related to theta function and some number theory results. So it will be interesting, but, well, I'm simply not able to cover it in this course due to time and because I'm not an expert in number theory. But there is an excellent paper of Pierre Cartier who explained connection of the Heisenberg group and theta function. So what about continuous one-dimensional subgroups? There are only two essential examples up to isomorphisms or conjugation. So that is, of course, the center of the Heisenberg group, which is one-dimensional, and this is clearly a subgroup. And another is a one-parameter subgroup, which belong to that subspace V1, when we decompose Heisenberg group in direct sum V0 and V1, so it belong to V1. Well, it's again useful exercise to practice here is to see what really this is a different example. So there is no automorphism of the Heisenberg group which map center to that subgroup H sub X. And of course, another point to verify is what any other one-dimensional subgroup shall be either belong to the shall be by automorphism put to these two subgroups. And essentially, again, to verify it, we may again easily do with consideration of Lie algebras. So one-parameter subgroups are generated by corresponding element of the Lie algebra. So we just look either generator of our one-dimensional subgroup belong to V0 or to complement of V0. And then to show, well, if it's V0 is one-dimensional, it is exactly generator of center. So when we are done, if it's in the complement, then it's just a matter of finding appropriate automorphism. Majority of this automorphism will be just symplectomorphism, which map generator of our subgroup to that one represented on the, by the identity 18. Well, if we have that one-dimensional subgroup, we may immediately build what are homogeneous spaces associated to this one-dimensional subgroup. Again, according to that formula which we had and diagram which we have a couple of slides before, calculation is not very difficult. So points, if we factorize with respect to center, if we consider a subgroup which is a center, we just parameterize the homogeneous spaces by coordinates x, y, which is a complement to the center in the Heisenberg group. And then the map S, which we take here, well, I made my efforts to put S, which is in the center of the group, is the real parameter, and map S, which we need here in different fonts. I don't know if it's clearly visible or not, what this is different fonts, not to mix that two things together. And embedding of the homogeneous space of or that representative from the Heisenberg group, which represents equivalence class, is given by simple formula. We just put zero as element of the center, and then really we are doing here very closely to corresponding linear algebra decomposition for the Weyl algebra of the Heisenberg group. Similarly, we may proceed with the case of the subgroup HX, but it's not so simple group law in this case. Again, embedding is rather simple. We just missing coordinates replaced by zero, and then this is how we embed points of homogeneous space, again, two-dimensional, to the Heisenberg group. And group law is calculated here. Again, because we are working with the nilpotent, with the Lie group, it's useful to have at hand derived action. So we have here action of the Heisenberg group on homogeneous spaces. These homogeneous spaces are differentiable manifolds. Very simply, it's really Euclidean spaces. So it's useful to see how corresponding generators of one-dimensional subgroups act in this case, and this is not very difficult calculation either. What about two-dimensional subgroups? Again, some consideration of elements in the Lie algebras lead us to the conclusion what a two-dimensional subgroup shall have this form. So we miss that component X. So here is subgroup, previously subgroup was HX. Now it's like complement to X, so it's H prime X. And corresponding homogeneous space is one-dimensional, clearly. So we introduce map S, taking out a representative, just again inserting zero on the missing coordinates, and then group law is another shift, or not group, action of the Heisenberg group on the real line, acts just by a shift by component X. Again, derived action, very easy to verify. It will be simply derivative. It will be derivative with respect to the variable X, which we have here. Now, that is quite elementary calculation, but situation is became more interesting if we are moving further to the group representation. So what is a group representation? Formal definition is just what we have a map from our group G to the group of homomorphism or, say, bounded linear operators in certain vector space. So this is a transformation of the group representation. And informally, for myself, I am thinking about that as follow. So group law, which is given to us, we consider as multiplication. When we put a representation when we map a group to bounded linear operation, that rule of group multiplication shall be preserved in, as a multiplication of operator, composition of operator. So what we are adding here, we add a linear structure. So for existing multiplication, we add certain addition and multiplication by scalars. So linear structure, which is compatible with the multiplication given by the group law. So this is adding the second operation, binary operation to our set, which preserve the algebraic structure. Well, this is the concept, and we really met the different type of representation from the very beginning when we start to study mathematics. So, for example, again, the group of reals with addition, which was already mentioned today, we may consider its representation by the following expression, by unimodular complex number. So we built an unimodular complex number based on real number x. And clearly, addition of reals correspond to multiplication of such unimodular complex numbers. So this is an example of a representation. Here, representation are one-dimensional in a one-dimensional vector space. So this representation have a special name. They play a special role. They are characters. So characters is, of course, the principal element when we are considering the Fourier transform on the, in abstract setting and other things. Next phase of a representation, if we take the same group, then we may consider the vector space of square integrable functions on the real line, and then our group of real act as shift on functions. And when shifting function, we of course preserve its norm, so it's again a unitary representation by unitary operators. And this time we have one-dimensional group, commutative group, which is represented as operator in certain infinite dimensional Hilbert space. So previous representation was one-dimensional, and this representation is infinite dimensional. Of course, if you're familiar with the theory of Fourier transform, you know what there is correspondence between these two representations, and somehow that again hinted what we are looking to a certain classification of representations up to natural isomorphism equivalence. Otherwise, of course, a number of representation will grow uncountable, uncontrollable, so we need somehow distinguish essentially different representation from just different faces of the same representation. So that's example one and two suggest such a problem. Then again, just to mention example, another of more general nature, so two previous examples was for specific group. In general, if we have the group G, we always may consider action of this group on functions which define it, this group. Here we have this left and right shift. Here this is the point where that minus power minus one appears practically. So here to make it homomorphism from the group structure, indeed shall be power minus one if you multiply from the left. Otherwise, it's first power if it's multiplied from the right. For non-commutative group, that is two different representation, but they are equivalent. So there is a very simple transformation which make that representation intertwined. And if we have something like Haar measure, invariant measure on our group, we may build unitary operators out of shift in the spaces of square integrable functions over Haar measure in this case. Again, a word of general nature. The same issue when we are studying representations, as with general mathematical structures, to describe them more completely, we typically decompose representation into smaller components. When this is possible? So if we are taking linear operators as representing elements of the group, and it's happened that there are certain vector subspaces in our space V which are invariant under all operators, when we may consider a restriction of our operators to these invariant subspaces, and when it will be action on some smaller space, that will be called sub-representation. So the situation is as follows. Sometimes when we are moving from representation to its sub-representation, what was cutted off may be sub-representation itself. So in this case, our representation can be decomposed into sum of two or more representations on different invariant subspaces, and when knowing the knowledge of these smaller sub-representations, we can build out the big representation as a sum of these sub-representations. Of course, we may continue with procedure if there are invariant subspaces until we reach the situation where our group act on our vector space without invariant subspaces for all elements. In this case, representation called irreducible. So irreducible is smaller block, smallest representation, which cannot be decomposed any further. And then we may, sorry, if we build out the full description of all such irreducible representation, we may hope what any other representation will be just a collection with probably certain multiplicity of this smaller building block irreducible representation. This is a general theory. So next lecture we will consider how this general theory works for the Heisenberg group. Are there questions? All right, thank you very much for your patience while we have fire alarm here and coming back with us. So hope to see you next week.